Partridge. Aha! Great, okay. Can we drop that now, please? Little albatross. Yeah, yeah, watch it, yeah. Who am I? I'm Alan Partridge. Are you Alan Partridge? No. Are you Alan Partridge? No. Chap over there looks a bit like a gypsy. Are you Alan Partridge? No, of course not. You couldn't host a nightly radio phone-in show, and I couldn't dump a burnt mattress in someone's back garden. So there are differences. Anyway, good evening, and welcome to the Royal Albert Hall for this evening to raise money for teenagers with cancer. We've got lots of wonderful people on the bill tonight. So we've got Rich Hall, Noel Fielding, Ricky Gervais, Little Britain, and my special guest, the original Milky Bar Kid. And, yeah. What a wonderful building. What a wonderful building. Now restored to its former glory after falling into disuse in the 1970s when it was used for illegal dogfights. Yeah, you can just imagine the heady atmosphere as two pit bulls would tear each other to pieces in front of 5,000 tattooed men with opera glasses. So, a little-known fact for you, for you up there in the boxes. It's reputed that the Albert Hall is haunted by the ghost of a young Molly Maguire who was stabbed to death in her dressing room in 1998. during a Human League reunion concert. Awful business, awful business. Anyone, tonight is going to be a tremendous evening. Only a couple of disappointments. Michael Flatley was going to be performing a 10-minute bare-chested extract from Lord of the Riverdance. But unfortunately, during rehearsals, he snagged his tights on a nail, fell off the stage, and died. there'll be a minute's silence for him during the interval. It's up to you if you want to observe it. You might want to combine it with a trip to the loo. Yeah. Kill two birds with one stone. Now, even sadder news than the tragic demise of Mr. Flatley is that we've run out of charity T-shirts. But we will get some more tomorrow. Now, there has been some concern that the T-shirts were being manufactured in Taiwanese sweatshops by small children. But I've made some inquiries, and I've been assured that the T-shirts are top quality. The children know exactly what they're doing. They have a very intensive training programme, so hope that allays your fears. OK, there are all kinds of marvellous people here tonight. The rock singer, Chris Martin, is here. Gwyneth Paltrow's let him in her box, and she's expecting their child. So well done, you two. Not the band, you two. I'm sure it's Chris's child. Anyway, by the way, Chris, you two aren't a patch on Coldplate. I love your latest album. Helps me relax while I'm doing my VAT returns in the conservatory. Just have it on in the background. Yeah. Why does it always rain on me? Lovely stuff, lovely stuff. Well done, Chris. Anyway, on with tonight's show. Tonight's show is about teenagers and teenage years. We all remember our teenage years and the difficulties, the problems, the fond memories, the long, hot summer days, running around, messing about in the water, laughing your head off, thinking, why am I so lonely? You know, sneaking behind the bike sheds for a kiss and a cuddle with the local slag. Okay? She'd give you a kiss for 10p, and for 20p, she'd let you see her vagina. Then, of course, came the explosion of puberty. I remember one day I was in the showers at school, and a boy remarked that my genitals looked like Dave Lee Travis. Kids can be cruel, and that kind of thing stays with you. In fact, I still can't get out of the shower and look in the mirror without thinking of the hairy cornflake. What a dick. I mean Dave Lee Travis, not you know. Anyway, what was I talking about? Teenage years. I actually just remembered a funny story from when I was 14. I was at school, and my best friend would eat vegetable soup, put it in his mouth, and pretend to be sick in the playground, and I would crawl over and pretend to eat it up like a dog. This is a schoolboy prank, you know. But it backfired, because we were in assembly, and he'd just had some bad scampi. I was genuinely sick, and to cut a long story short, I ended up with child sick in my mouth. Sorry about that, sorry. So the irony is that I was then genuinely sick, and I was standing in line, and I was sick on the back of the boy in front of me, and he in turn was sick on the back of the boy in front of him. And it started off a whole chain reaction, rather like dominoes, or vominoes. 9 boys in a row, must have been extraordinary, one after the other. I remember the last one had a kind of double kick. Came straight down his nostrils, like a double-barrel shotgun. Bang! Went straight over the shoulders of the boy in front of him, thus breaking the chain. Salad days. I don't want to bring the evening down, but please do not bring hot drinks into the auditorium. It's a legal thing. If you spilt some on a famous celebrity, then, you know, we could end up being sued. So, you know, if, for instance, you spilt boiling hot tea onto Chris Moyles' lap, or better still, his face, then, I meant to think that, not say it. Sorry about that. Mind you, if you did disfigure him, he could still carry on radio, couldn't he? There's no justice. Okay, on with the show. Now it's time for somebody very, very special indeed. A man who's been making us laugh for a long time. Please welcome Academy Award winner, Ricky Gervais!
Thank you very much. It's an absolute pleasure to be here at this charity event. I don't do enough for charity. I do a bit, but you can always do more, I suppose. But I look at it like this. It's a pain, isn't it? So, do you know what I mean? Nothing in it for me. No. A lot of the acts you'll see, you know, they're either on their way up and they need to, or they're on their way down, some of them, or they've got a film coming out. It's a waste of evening for me, but, no, all the money is going to teenage cancer. And I say all the money, obviously, after expenses. I came by helicopter. It's fucking brilliant. It's brilliant. Oh. Got the receipt. But there are so many charities these days, and I keep getting called, and I can't do them all. When I was growing up, there was 2. Oxfam and Spastics. That's all. You knew where you were. I mean, Oxfam's still going strong, of course. I mean, if you've got shares in that, you've done well, because you'll always have famine. You'll always have famine. Spastics is a word you don't hear so much these days. Again, all the rage in the 70s, but they changed their name. They changed their name to Scope from the Spastic. True, they changed their name to Scope. And they changed their name from Spastic Society to Scope because spastic was being used as a derogatory term. Particularly in the playground, like, bullies were picking on disabled kids and stuff. So they changed the name, so that doesn't happen. Now what would happen if a bully had a little, you know, go at a little fellow in a wheelchair? He'd go, "Oi, spastic!" And the little fellow would go, "I think you'll find it Scope." And he'd go, "Oi, Scopey, fuck." My impression of a wheelchair user. Not for a herd, that would just be that. Because she had one of those. She didn't even bother with that shit. Bzzz. Never off her arse, was she, Thorhood? Never off her arse. No, she'd go shopping in one of those things, bzz, right up to her front door, and up the Stanner stairlift, feet haven't touched the ground yet, up to the bathroom, lowered into the bath. Never off her... Give her an award, and she's up there like a fucking greyhound. Same as that Stephen Hawking, lazy. Most intelligent man on the planet, and I'm having a go. Brilliant. Most intelligent man, not such a good judge of character, is he, really? Allegedly, I don't know. But happily married. But he couldn't believe that. His nurse shows him a bit of attention. He goes off with her, and now, according to some, she leaves him out in the sun, smacks him round the head. He must be thinking, what happened to all the blowjobs? Spell the whole word. Ouch. But it's not true. There's no evidence to be sort of, so it's not true. I think you probably got all those bruises doing fucking skateboarding. But, yeah, poor bloke. But on a more positive note, I've had a good year. Yeah. I've had a great year. Been playing a lot of tennis. Went to America, did Alias. Won a couple of Globes. No, I'm not telling you that to show off. I want you to compare that with the week I had before I went to America. That wasn't such a good week. I was at home and I was watching telly, and it was a Saturday night, and this programme came on. Did you see Celebrity Stars and Their Doubles with Dale Winton? Yeah, there was a Brent lookalike on, and he won his category. Just a fat bloke. Just a fat bloke. And when he went up to get the award, he was so fat that he waddled. Right. Dale Winton said, "Oh, you even walk like Ricky Gervais." Not even David Brent now, but just, oh, about 45, about 16 stone, just a fat bloke. On the other side, the same night, absolutely true, was that programme to get the top 10 British sitcoms of all times. They voted the top 10 in. And The Office, we didn't get in the top 10, we got to number 25, which is fine, because I can think of at least 10 sitcoms, which I think is better than The Office. Nicker and Dibley wouldn't be one of them, but I wasn't asked. Dawn French came second in the Brent lookalike competition. Just a fat bloke. So I'm wearing black tonight. It's slimming. No, it works. Pavarotti wears a lot of black, and you see him in pasta and he's a fat little fucker. So, he came third. I've done a few charity events before, and I did one that was for raising money for third world workers in sweatshops. And it was sort of linked to designer labels who use these sweatshops, and there was some frightening statistics. It was, particularly in China, it says women and children, they work for like a few pence an hour, and it's just awful conditions. And there was this statistic that the CEO of Nike has amassed $5.2 billion, and for a Chinese woman in one of his factories to earn that much, she'd have to work 8 hours a day, 7 days a week for 10,000 years. But they don't want to. Lazy. There was another thing on there that one of the supervisors in one of these sweatshops was accused of sexual harassment, and he was fired, but he fled the country before he could come to trial. And a press conference, the CEO of Nike, I think it's Philip Knight, was questioned about this, and he said no. It was a misunderstanding. He wasn't sexually harassing her. He was trying to wake her up, and he must have touched the wrong places. That's a bad excuse, isn't it? Mrs. Chang. Mrs. Chang. Mrs. Chang. Mrs. Chang. Just such a terrible excuse. It's that I love when people sort of put on the spot with something so embarrassing as that. I remember a friend of mine qualified for medical college, and he did his junior doctorship or intern in University College Hospital. And he was doing the rounds one night, and this guy came in with a sauce bottle, a little sauce bottle, stuck up his ass. He was lost up there, he had to go to the hospital. And instead of going, "But you know what I was doing, get it out, I won't do it again," he had to go through this whole, to save face, this whole accident report. And the guy said, "I've been shopping at Safeway. And I came home with..." Absolutely true, by the way. I came home and I put the shop in on the doorstep and I realised, I'd locked myself out of my house. So I saw a window open and I started to climb up the drain pipe and my trousers and pants fell down. Ooh, embarrassing. And I slipped and fell. I must have landed right on the bottle, and it's up there now. And my mate added to the end of this report, he said, "This story would be somewhat more believable if Safeway sold their ketchup bottles with a condom already attached." Just forgotten about it. And why did he put a condom on it? So he bought this, so either he was scared to catch someone from this brand new bottle, or he was going to use it later on his chips. How fucking mean is that? They're 79p. If you're into shoving stuff up your arse, have two sets, one for chips, one for arses. It's so... Cutlery. Cutlery for fish, cutlery for arses. Then you won't need to make up terrible excuses. It's just... Mrs. Chang. Talking of third world sweatshops, I want to leave you with a true story about how we can make a difference, and you are making a difference tonight, and that's fantastic. A little while ago, a friend of mine, Rob, he had to go shopping for a suit for a funeral, a family funeral, and he was on the dole. He was in a band, but he was earning no money for that, and he was signing on. He didn't have a suit, but he had to get this one. So I went with him, and we went to those sort of cheap shops in Oxford Street, and we were saying that we haven't got any money, and what have you got? And this one guy said, oh, we've got a brand new suit. It's lovely. It's the last one. It's a lovely range. It's £39. And so I thought, I can't wait to see this fucking suit. £39. When I got there, it's brand new. It's not in a sale. It's really well made. Sort of dark suit. It even had a sort of electric blue sort of satin lining. Really nice. And my mate was made up. And then I pissed on his bonfire and I said, you know, if it's that good and it's brand new and it's not in a sale, then probably someone's been exploited. You know, what I said was... the sweatshops where they get them to do this for like a few pence. That's why I can make it that cheap. And he went, oh, for fuck's sake. And he didn't buy it. And I think, well, that, you know, even though I sort of wind up a little bit, I thought, that's changed someone's attitude and it sort of made a difference. So, you know, you can make a difference. So, still, 39 quid. Thank you. Good night. Cheers. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much to Richard Jarvis. Actually, the subject of a fascinating documentary on BBC Two about life in an office. Although, I've got to be honest, I watched it and I thought it was more like a comedy. But, yeah, but there's a lot of this reality TV on at the moment. You know, Sid Vicious in the jungle with Sam Fox. It's rubbish. Now, there are several celebrities who unfortunately couldn't make it tonight. JK, the hat-wearing pretend environmentalist from Jamiroquai, said he'd love to help out, but... unfortunately, he's watching himself being interviewed on Men in Motors and can't be asked to set the video. So, fair enough, fair enough. At least he's honest. Paul Young won't be appearing because, well, we didn't ask him. But lots of celebrities have done the kind service of donating personal possessions for auction. We have the lovely Tanya here, who's modelling for us. Lovely Tanya, lovely legs. Now, Tanya is displaying a pair of Umbro running shorts, which were previously mine. Like a lot of memorabilia, they have seen better days. The stitched-in genital hammock finally gave way last week as I was reaching up to change a light bulb. Yeah. So you don't need a genital hammock, do you? No. I hope not. Can't tell these days, it's very difficult to tell. But I was reaching out to change a light bulb, and in fact, to anyone below, it must have looked like there were two more light bulbs. And, a penis. There's all manner of lovely things being donated. Lawrence Llewellyn Bowen has actually sod him. I want to starve that man of the oxygen of publicity. And the oxygen of air. What did he send us? Look at that. His autobiography and one ticket for the Ideal Home exhibition. The fucking nerve. Lawrence Llewellyn Bowen. He's a kind of Adam Ant for Daily Mail readers. Now, Lot 3 is... Roger Daltrey has kindly donated his garage door. It's one of a pair. It's been in Luke for 5 weeks and he can't shift it. He's invested in a new traditional wooden door, which is light-sensitive to the approach of his Volvo XC90, which he's asked us to mention. Not sure why. There you go. You can take it off now, lads. Tanya has two other items. You can take the door away now. Thanks. Unbelievable. Tanya has two more items. This is Dennis Waterman's original suede jacket from Minder, which has a reserve price of 50p. Right Said Fred have donated as a T-shirt. Didn't even ask them for it. I think it's a desperate bid to get back in the limelight. Yeah. I won't bother auctioning that. Just drop it in at the Scope shop on Monday. So, I won't make a special trip. I'm just actually travelling to see my sister. Although she's a bit depressed. She's just had an hysterectomy. You ain't my womb. Anyway, thanks to Tanya for all that money. Look at those legs. Look at those legs. They're marvellous. They, you could straddle a car with those. Yeah. Not a big one, you know, a Toyota Yaris. Yeah. So, by the way, Tanya's not for auction. Yeah. No, I wouldn't like to put a reserve price on her. What'd it be, about 500 quid for the night? 650, done. I mean, sorry. Anyway, I'm getting... I think we all got a bit confused there. We'll talk about this out there. That's for everything. Yeah, OK, right. OK, we'll talk about that out there. Thanks, Tanya. OK. Anyway, sorry about that. Now, please welcome on the next act, the star of BBC Two's Marion and Jeff. Please welcome Mr. Rob Brydon.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How are you? Poor people up there. But think how they feel. Now, those of you sitting there thinking that I'm losing my hair, I'm not. It's the lights. I just got back from a special screening of Spider-Man 2. You may not have heard this, but Tobey Maguire in the new one is playing him Welsh.
All right. Peter Parker, my name is. Incredible thing happened. I've been bitten by a spider. Unbelievable. To make matters worse, it's only bloody radioactive.
Fuck. Who is telling him to zoom in?
It's turned my life around, in all honesty. I'm shooting webs out of my hand. I'm climbing walls about 600 feet. As a rule, I tend to go about this high, as I'm not good with heights. Rightly or wrongly, the only downside of being imbued with the qualities of a spider, as far as I can tell, is I am finding it very difficult getting in and out of the bath. You cannot have a Welsh superhero. It would never work, with the exception of one man. Yeah! Oh, that's nice. Oh, don't stop what you're doing, my love. Oh, ah, mind your teeth. Anthony Hopkins. No, I am talking about Sir Tom Jones. I saw the light on the night that I passed by her window. She always leaves her downstairs light on when she goes out, for peace of mind. I'm always clearing my bloody throat and looking slightly startled. Stereophonics. Pussycat, I love you. But society frowns on it. I think it's growing back. The only one who could ever reach me was the son of a preacher man. But now that I'm with T-Mobile, you can get me anywhere. There are some glasses here.
I'll never forget the day.
I'm with Ronnie Corbett.
My great-grandfather was killed at the Ronnie Corbett at the Battle of Little Bighorn. He wasn't involved in the fighting. He was camping in a nearby field and popped over to complain about the noise.
I'm a Thomasaurus. How old are you? Oh, lovely. Okay. Mama told me. She did, honestly. It's her fault. He's too loud. He has a problem with his volume. When he was at his little son, his wife would say, Tom, now look, we got the boy off to sleep. He's almost gone. You just rock him off now the last few minutes, all right?
All right, give him to me. Where's that lovely baby? There we are.
Oh, little baby! Sleep for your daddy! Ow! He's woken up, love.
Thanks very much to little Bobby Dryden. Good to see that Welsh people have stopped being annoying and are now trendy. It's a charity evening. Many of you will know that I do a lot of work for homeless people, or as they used to be known, tramps. I actually was homeless myself a few years ago when my wife locked me out of the house and I had to spend 5 hours walking around John Menzies. And let me tell you, it gets pretty lonely out there. But during that time, I learnt a lot about life and other things like caravanning, fishing, antiques and collectibles, and soft porn. But the traditional image of the tramp has changed. For example, they are no longer all Scottish. Actually, when they were all Scottish, I actually went to Scotland to see if all their tramps were English. But no, they were Scottish too. Bit of a wasted journey. Sadly, a lot of drug addicts, unfortunately, are on heroin, which is terribly sad. Personally, the only heroine I'd like to inject myself into is the lovely Kate Adie, who no doubt right now is smuggling herself into Iran, disguised as a woman. We're going to take a break here. I'll be back on chatting to the original Milky Bar Kid. And just to warn you, when I come back on, I may be in a hilarious disguise. Get yourself a Brit, Vic. See you in 20.
Or I'm Alla Partridge. They both work. Ha ha ha. Ah. Oh, hello, madam. Do you like my suspect package? Ha ha ha. It's been unattended for ages. Ha ha. Oh, watch it, you lot. I'm Alla Partridge. Shiver me timbers. Where's my mate with the hook? He'll be along soon, and then you're all for it. Ha ha. Go on, hiss me, boo me, ho.
I think this has backfired. Sorry about that. It's, it was actually Ricky Gervais's idea. But, clearly been set up. A man's a shit. The beard, actually, is from another costume. I was actually in rehearsals for a stage version of Jesus of Nazareth. It's very good. I play Jesus, of course, and I've got a great cast. David Dickinson is Judas Iscariot. It's a marvellous scene where he gets the 30 pieces of silver and then he turns to the audience, winks and says, cheap as chips. It's a bit of fun, a bit of fun. Pontius Pilate is played by Les Dennis. And Noel Edmonds is John the Baptist. It's a very moving scene at the end when his head is presented on a silver platter to Salome, played by Jade from Big Brother. Bit of fun. It's a more light-hearted approach than the Passion of the Christ. I actually wonder if Jesus came back down to Earth, do you think he'd actually go and see the Passion of the Christ? Probably doesn't want to be reminded of all that. He'd probably be nudging you during the film, saying, you know, that didn't happen. You know, and Calvary's not that steep. You know, you're trying to watch the film, Jesus. I think if Jesus was in the mood for a Mel Gibson film, he'd probably want something light, like What Women Want. I'm sorry if all my multi-religious reflections have actually offended anyone. Certainly don't mean to do that. Hello?
Can I have a quick word?
I'm in the middle of a show, so...
Can I have a quick word, Mr. Partridge?
Right. Who are you?
I'm a police officer.
Right. Right, but you're not going to take your clothes off.
No, I'm a real police officer.
Okay, right. Who are you?
I'm a police officer.
Right, so yes, I knew that. I panicked and asked the question again. what's the problem?
I need to have a quick word.
Right. Can I finish the show and then we do this out there?
Yeah, I need to talk immediately.
Right, okay, what's the problem?
You've been reported as making some comments about you representing some illegal terrorist organisation. Can you explain what that's about?
Yeah, I was just doing a joke about terrorists.
Right. Of course, obviously, you know, in the current climate, you can understand we have to take every threat seriously.
Yeah. Come on, mate, look at my shoes. Oh, like Ali Bongo. He's not on your list, is he? Just trying to break the ice. Light it up, flatfoot TJ Hooker.
You see, I can appreciate that, you know, what you were saying was in jest.
It was in jest. I got this from Hamleys.
Yeah, Alan. I know.
I mean, I wouldn't take it on an aeroplane.
Alan, this is...
No, not in my hand baggage, anyway.
This is a public place, yeah. Okay? In the current state of alert, yeah. Right, you could be causing a breach of the peace, okay? Yeah. People are very nervous. Yeah. Now, you could have caused a panic. It hasn't happened here now, but it could happen another time.
Well, I definitely will never ever dress as Alan Qaeda ever again. So I swear. I swear on the Bible. And the Quran.
Where's the costume from?
The costume is actually, it's not mine, it's actually from, it's Angel's costume is. Actually, it's the costume woman, she hired it. I don't know who else she's hired them for. I can give you a name I want. It's Marcia Stanton. She lives in South London. She thinks she's got a house in Brighton.
Okay, Alan, I'm not interested in that.
Okay, right. Okay, well,
All right, so, look.
You're not going to lock me up in Montego Bay, are you? where you make all the terrorists wear red jumpsuits.
I'm sure what will happen, there'll be a lengthy conversation and you'll get some kind of verbal warning.
Okay, yeah, great, fine.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to wait for you off stage. All right, I'm going to let you get on with this performance.
Okay, right, thank you.
All right, but when you're done, I'm going to need to talk to you.
Okay, fine. You can wait in my dressing room if you want. There's a mini bar and a bed. You can have a kip if you like. Actually, if you go in my bag, I think you'll find a large bag of Walker's Sensations. Sea salt and black cracked pepper, I think it's the final. Help yourself to those. Actually, there's a TV. If you put the TV on, you should catch the end of Midsummer Murders. Yeah. Keep the old grey cells. Yeah. Okay, yeah, so fine. Is it gone? And now the Birmingham Six felt now. Unbelievable. Okay, on with the show. And please welcome
a very funny man, Mr. Otis Lee Crenshaw.
Keeping that going until I was about 3 feet from the microphone. Just the kind of wave of confidence that a man needs to surf far at all. Good evening. How are you? Can I just say this is the most fantastic fucking venue we've ever had the pleasure of performing in? Jesus Christ, what a wedding cake. What a great big old tear of Liberace's intestines. Normally the kind of places that I'm playing have drains on the floor. It's for fucking cancer. You'd think they could turn on the fucking piano. Entertain yourself for a second, fella. Yeah, it's always one goddamn button, isn't it? How you doing here, fella? Look at you with your big suntan. Big smile on your face. Kind of a green, kind of lawn furniture looking shirt, fella. You look kind of relaxed. But I don't see you sitting beside no woman now, do I? No, I don't see that at all. See you sitting between two new media types, thinking that maybe you're going to go home alone tonight with just a green shirt and that big smile on your face, fella, do you? Believe me, Otis knows what it's like to be lonely. You find yourself licking ashtrays because you heard it's kind of like kissing a woman who smokes. Christ almighty. So you and I got something in common, don't you, fella? But look up and down that aisle right there. You see a lot of good-looking women. What kind of work you do? You. I don't have a lazy eye. Who else is wearing a fucking green shirt? Yes, you. Who the hell else would I be talking to? When you get up in the morning, where do you go? You're an undertaker. Get the fuck out of here. Christ almighty, how much work do you bring home with you in the evening? You're an undertaker? You're the happiest looking fucking undertaker I've ever seen in my life. Jesus Christ. So you got a sweetheart? Anyone you can practice on? No wonder you're alone. What kind of creepy woman would go out with a fucking happy undertaker? At least wear a fucking stovetop type hat or something to long black veil, something. Some white carriages parked out front. Jesus Christ, you're scaring the hell out of me. I wouldn't want to be dead and then wake up and see your fucking big toothy grin staring me in the face. Well, the waking up part I wouldn't mind, but Jesus Christ, tone it down, will you? Ever been to Nashville, fella? Whose sister? Don't drag his sorry ass into it. You're on your own here, all right? You like country music there, Mr. Undertaker boy? Do you? I'll bet you've been right here on this stage watching Shania Twain or some other country twit like that. Yeah. Well, I don't think she's ever actually stood on this stage, or Garth Brooks, or they can both kiss my ass, because I'm here and they're playing in the fucking festival hall or some other shithole. Nope, this is where it's happening. You know who's played here? Frank Sinatra played here in 1995. One of his last gigs, I was talking to a stagehand, and I said, well, do you still have it together? And he said, yeah, right up to the point where he started singing Luck Be a Monkey Tonight, he seemed to have it together. But I'm not talking about Shania or Garth, because she could kiss my ass with her big bullshit kind of female. None of that subservience that characterized the great country female singers of the 60s. Shania is all, oh, that don't impress me much. You're from Canada. Anything would impress you, and you know it, Shania, all right? Beaver pelt would impress you. Bachman Turner Overdrive tribute bands. Oh, you're a rocket scientist. That don't impress me. Well, that would fucking impress me. How many opportunities you get to meet a rocket scientist in your life? Mandatory blow job, all right? Oh, you're all right. That don't keep me warm at night. Well, buy a blanket. Those real country music, Undertaker boy, and I think you're going to follow along with this. It's lying there on the floor with a bottle of Jack Daniels in your hand. Still alive. Sorry to bring you down, but... because a woman's gonna walk across your heart like a Samoan man in golf shoes, and you think, God, there ought to be a way to take all this heartache and depression and turn it into some instant cash. Go down there to Nashville to record your songs, and they say, oh, it's too dark and depressing, Otis. Sorry, only Undertaker types would listen to this kind of music. So here's one that's bypassed Nashville for a couple of months now. Go out walking. Just us two, ain't much in this world I wouldn't do for you, and every man with a knife said your money or your life, I wouldn't think twice. And I'd stand my ground and not give an inch, coiled like a spring, I wouldn't even flinch, and I would stare into the eyes of that son of a bitch, and this is what I'd say. Do anything you want to the girl, just don't hurt me. I might be crazy, but I ain't reckless. She's got a diamond ring, she's got a necklace. Look in her purse, you'll find keys to a Lexus. Me, I'll be on my way. Do anything you want to the girl, just don't hurt me. Hey, what a funny old way to measure love. Find out where you stand when push comes to shove. Cause right now it ain't you that I'm thinking of. It's me, it's me. It's me, 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 me. I'd love me. Do anything you want to the girl, just don't hurt me. Two's company, but three's a crowd. I was thinking maybe we should break up anyhow. I could use some space from you, especially right now. So help yourself, mister. I ain't no hero. Her bank card pin number is 4130. Do anything you want to the girl, just don't hurt me. Sing along, Undertaker boy. Sing! Do anything you want to the girl, just don't hurt me. Rejected by every major label in Nashville. Mr. Myron T. Buttram on the guitar, ladies and gentlemen. Very sexy guitar player there. I love London. Don't let anybody tell you. Every day I love to wake up in London and think, what kind of shit is going to happen to me today that I just fucking wasn't expecting? Just roadworks, congestion charge, personal humiliation, public degradation. But you don't get shot in the fucking head. That's the best thing about London right there. America, have a nice day. Then they shoot you in the head, right? Britain, nobody would ever say, have a nice day, because it's not possible to completely have a nice fucking day in Britain, so why even suggest it? Someone said, hey, have a nice quarter of an hour. You go, oh, thank you very much. That's manageable. We're going to host the Olympics here, 2012, possibly. And that's exactly the level of excitement that you see about that whole project right there. Tell Brits, that'd be great. Olympics in London, that's fantastic. And they go, yeah, so... what's the point? What? Well, you invite people from all over the world, the greatest athletes. Ah, it'll be a fucking mess. I can't believe that attitude. Then I went to Hackney. Have a look for myself. And, you got a long way to go, all right? Fucking Hackney. Home of the Olympics. Jesus Christ almighty. Largest amount of mental health in the country is in Hackney. They're going to host a normal Olympics. That's bullshit. Fucking, what a shithole. Kayaking down the Lee River. Mm-hmm. You can develop film in the Lee River, but I don't see kayaking down it. That's for fucking sure. Tell you the truth, most Olympic events are heartbreaking. You know, that's the great thing about Brits is they would argue out of most events. They just go, what's the point of that? And you go, well, yeah, I guess you're right. That's hurling hammers and throwing iron fucking balls and javelins. Jesus Christ, it's 2004. Evolve, for fuck's sake. You would. British event. How far do you think you would have thrown the javelin had you actually bothered? Well, that far. Oh, I'm going to have a beer. What if you think about it, you know. Let's say you're the world's greatest pole vaulter. Gold medal. When will you ever get to pole vault again in your life? You'd just be standing there waiting for an opportunity every moment of your waking day. What's that, Timmy? Your ball's on the roof. That's fantastic. I'm going to get my 12-foot pole, hurl myself right up on the roof, and I'll... Oh, you got a ladder. Oh, shit. You live in London there, Mr. Undertaker boy? Where do you live? Where do you live? Where? Barn ditch. Barn... Forget it. It's not on our tour, and I can't waste any more time. Sick kids getting sicker, and while you're wasting fucking time. Everybody, I've seen, I read obituaries when I travel around in Britain. Everybody seems to die either peacefully or suddenly. Those are your two choices in Britain. Always count up the number of suddenlies versus peacefullies, because if there's more suddenlies than peacefullies, I get the hell out of there, no matter what town that is. I want to die both peacefully and suddenly. Get hit by a truck full of chamomile tea. This one's for you, fella. I got a George Foreman grill. I've got a George Foreman grill. If you won't cook my dinner, George Foreman will. I've got a George Foreman grill. I've got a George Foreman. If you won't cook my dinner, George Foreman will. He was a master of masters in the sweetest science. To you, he's just a name on a kitchen appliance. How could you be so stupid? How could you be so dumb not to know? George Foreman was as mean as it come. I've got a George Foreman grill. I've got a George Foreman grill. If you won't cook my dinner, George Foreman will. I've got a George Foreman grill. I've got a George Foreman grill. If you won't cook my dinner. He went 8 rounds in Kinshasa with Muhammad Ali. He didn't float like a butterfly or sting like a bee. He just lay on that canvas all quiet and still, but he was dreaming up the plans for a cheap sandwich grill. It could take all your fat and reduce it by half, 'cause the name of the game is to have the last laugh when you fight for the glory. The day finally comes when your face is on a kitchen counter covered in crumbs. I've got a George Foreman grill. Sing! George Foreman grill. Sing, Undertaker boy, or I'll kill you! Everybody! I've got a George Foreman grill. Sing! It's for cancer, you bastards! If you won't cook my dinner, George Foreman will. Mr. Myron T. Buckram on the guitar, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
I love you too, but not in a gay way. thank you to Otis Lee Crenshaw. I would, although this is a charity event, I would like to use the opportunity to read an extract from my new novel, which has real film potential, if anyone out there has access to funding. Okay, it's a nightmare vision of the future, and it's called Angliageddon. The whole of Norfolk is waterlogged. Home insurance is a thing of the past. You would think in the future things would get better, but no, they're worse. A lot of people are mad and eat pets. The anti-hunting lobby have finally won the day, and foxes have, as feared, grown to 5 times their normal size. And now carry off babies and small electrical goods. People have 3D TVs on their wrist and go around on monorails, like the one at Gatwick Airport. People are fed up voting for governments who just take taxes and teachers taking liberties. Cyberpunks roam the streets wreaking havoc as a direct response to the extension of the congestion charge. Red King Ken Livingstone, the 8th, has 6 wives, but not separately, all at the same time. That's the twist. 3 turn out to be evil robots. Anne Boleyn, Jane Seymour, and Anne of Cleves are robots, but they only find out when they chop their heads off and there are a load of wires. But they keep talking for about an hour until the batteries run out. Is this the future we want? 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 No, absolutely not. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, I think I think I surprised a few people with that. I'm not sure what to do with that. I'll either develop it as a movie with 20th Century Fox, or I'll take it to the Edinburgh Festival as a one-man show. Of course, this isn't a one-man show, and coming up very soon, we've got the Milky Bar Kid. But before that, please welcome one of the men with the most fashionable haircuts in British comedy. Please welcome Noel Fielding.
Look at all you. Let's just move this out of the way. Look at you, lady. You've got a face. I've got a face. It's all going to be all right. How are you, sir? I feel like you're miles away. Come on, let's touch quickly. Come on, let's touch. Like I'm Christ and you're a leper kind of a way. I'm only joking. Look at you, sir. You want to get involved, don't you? Get on stage. Jump or get on stage. Get naked. I'll get on top of you. Not in a gay way. Like 2 soldiers away from home missing their wives. Having a bit of a cuddle in bunk beds. It'll be great, come on, look at you, sir, you're right, I'm feeling pretty good. Wow, it's too big to even, I can't even see. It's great, wow, it's lovely. It looks round from the outside, but it's kind of oblong. Kind, that's my favourite word as well, oblong. That is a genius word. When you're little and you first hear that, you go, oblong, how cool is that? Fucking oblong, 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 you just say it for hours. But then there's like a cut-off point when you get to about 17, you're not allowed to say it anymore, you have to say rectangle. You can't get men to say oblong, they won't do it. You go oblong, and your dad goes, I think you'll find it's rectangle. You say oblong, and they go, no, really, I couldn't, it's rectangle. That's what I do in the afternoons. I go about town, I go up to Liverpool Street, and I go up to the businessmen and say, come on, say oblong, and they go, no, really, I couldn't. There's no way, and I go, come on, just come down this alley with me, come on. Come on, come on, baby, come on, come on, come say oblong, what's happening, come on, come on, come on, little piece of chicken, come say oblong. Come on, come on, come on, baby. I go and get them by the hand and go, come on, come on. And I lead them down the alley and I sit them down on a little stool made of ice and it melts and they lower down and they lose their confidence and they sit there and I go, go on, you can say oblong, say it. And they go, do you really think I could say oblong? I go, yeah. And they go, okay. Oblong. I get out a dictaphone and go, I've got it on tape. And they go, no. And I go to where they work and go, look what he said. He said oblong. And they all go, he said oblong. And then I tape them saying it. Pretty soon I was running the entire city with the power of oblong. So don't try and take me on. So You all right up there? How's it going? Oh, wow, it's pretty cool. This is a weird old gig. Hey, look at you. You need to be a peregrine falcon to make this gig work. You all right there? Oh, shit, they're everywhere. Look at you lot, you little beagles. Come on. I'd love to suckle your heads like Chupa Chup lollies. That would be my main ambition, just to leap onto you. I'm pretty bored, though, being a man. It's great when you're a kid, but when you're a man, there's not much you can do, is there? You need drugs, money, the lot. But when you're a little kid, it's anything's fun. You're there, you're 6 years old, it's summer holidays, you go, I'm bored, what am I going to do? And you look down, and your socks have slipped down, you've got really long feet, and you go, fucking hell, that's a game in itself. Check me out. I'm the sock demon of old London town. And you're just there, whipping the cat in the eye. Woo-choo! And the cat's all scrunched up in the corner, going, I can do you close range. You go, yeah, but from where I'm standing, you're nothing, Tiddles. Take that. Your mum tries to ruin it. Goes, pull your socks up. You trip over. You go, I don't trip over. I'm 6 years old. Check me out. Look at me moving around. And you get it caught under the coffee table and go, oh, but mums can never be right. So you carry on anyway. I've got to carry on. And she's going, oh, you go, there's no situation here. It'll be fine. Oh, keep walking. Keep walking. And you get to Paris and it's really taut at that point. Oh, please. And then your brother nips out and cuts it and it shoots out in the air and hits a chaffinch in flight. Imagine having that as one of your punchlines. But my brother, he was a right little minx, because he's younger than me, and I used to really... I mean, I don't know about you, so if you've got a younger brother, but basically, if you have, you just beat the living shit out of them. I used to give my brother dead arms, dead legs. Not the punches. I used to go down to the morgue and bring him back limbs. The best thing I ever did to my brother, though, is I told him... He thought, right, there was a monster living under his bed, because I told him there was, right, and he was terrified, right? And one night, I saw him in his little pyjamas. He must have been about 9, and I was about 11. He's in his little pyjamas, getting ready in the bathroom, yeah, cleaning his teeth like this. Because he used to clean his teeth with maracas, right? And he was there. And I saw him and thought, I'll get under his bed, right? Pretend to be the monster. Genius. He'll have a heart attack. He'll actually die. Don't know how I'm going to explain that to mum, but it doesn't matter, right? So I got under his bed and I was there. I could scarcely contain myself. I was going, this is genius. He's going to freak out. And I turned around, there was a monster there like that. He went, this is my motherfucking patch. I mean, all right. I was furious. Usurped by the monster. I thought, I said to him, who says you can get under people's beds? Maybe I'll get under your bed. And I went to where he lived. I thought, I'm not having this. This is revenge. I'm only 9, but I'm going to take him on his own game. So I went to where he lived, but unfortunately, he lived in Milton Keynes. It took me ages. I was only 9. I had to get a coach. I had to hitchhike some of the way. Big man with a beard picked me up, put me in his beard. I had to live in his weird beard world for a year. It was horrible in there. There were cats in there with no whiskers. I didn't know what was going on. It's a shambles. He pulled me out. He went, the monster lives up there. So I ran up there. I went, revenge is mine. I went up to the monster's house. It was locked. So I kicked down the door. I didn't care. I thought, I'm going to get under his bed. I ran up the stairs, went into his bedroom. He had a futon. Oh. I got under anyway. I was like that. I won't be beaten. I could only move my eyelids. I don't know how I was going to jump out on him. He came in. He knew I was there. He pulled me out. I was all waiting for him. Put me in a book with other humans. Every now and then monsters would come around and look through it and go, I like page 42. Never my page. But I remember when I was about 14, my mum found a condom in my room and she went mental, not just mad. She went around town putting men in wicker. She went crazy. Mind you, it was on the end of an erect zebra's penis, so that might have been why. She'd come in with clean towels and the zebra would be chasing around the room and she'd have to beat him off with the towels. Don't be rude now. And she left my dad for him. He was kind of a father to me, just a long-nosed, stripy father. It's amazing though. I remember in the summer holidays, he used to take me out on a little boat, a little rowing boat, no water, just in the forest like that. And he hired two otters to just push the side. They were nice. You could get them both on a sort of cheap deal. And we'd just sit there. And it was in the 70s. I remember he used to have big 70s shirts on. Phew, big 70s shirts. Amazing they were. And he'd sit there with his zebra face looking at me. And I'd think, what's happening? And I'd look at him like that. And he'd unbutton his 70s shirt and the moonlight would come down. And I never forget this. He had metallic nipples. It's amazing. And the moonlight would come down and shine off his metallic nipplets, whoosh, and creating a little light beam. Oh, little light rod. Oh, coming towards my eye. Oh, and as they get used to get there, like little fluorescent spears, I used to just pull across a zinc eye patch and they would ricochet back at him, yeah? It was like light tennis. It was amazing. But he knew the score. He already had a strontium roll neck on. He was there with top spin. But what he didn't realise is I'd hired a Norman helmet. Must have been 97% titanium, right down the bridge of the nose. It's got to have been titanium. I was there, come on, I'll take you on. We used to play that for about 11 hours. And then eventually, a man made entirely of silhouette would come up and go, enough. Is that weird? That's the only dad I know. So, I once tracked a unicorn to the ends of the earth. Eventually caught up with it, and it turned out to be a white horse with a cornetto stuck on its head. Oh, I was so annoyed. And in the hot afternoon sun, the cornetto slipped down his long face and just flicked up in the air. And I grabbed it, went, I'll have that, make up for some of the time I spent looking for you, you hoax. Yeah, see you later. I turned around, he didn't give a shit. He was leaning on a freezer full of magnums. Oh, wasn't even a white horse, it's a brown horse with an ice cream man's jacket on. He had a van and everything. How'd you drive it? I've got a small Argentinian boy. I don't need to tell you my business. Oh, so annoyed. Anyway, the last thing I want to tell you before I go is, you know the silver grey monkey? The slightly twisted, always looking monkey? The slightly twisted, always looking on tippy-toe monkey? The slightly twisted, always looking snooker referee waistcoat long poles hitting the tiny mice skulls, hitting the tiny mice skulls, monkey? Living in a huge house made of bus receipts, monkey? The slightly twisted, always looking creepy, tippy-toe, looking bus receipts, long poles, hitting the mouse's skulls, hitting the mouse's skulls, monkey. He was my father. He was my father. Imagine ending a gig like that. You've been great. Cheers. Thanks a lot. Cheers.
Oh. Hey. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Okay, now it's time for a lovely white chocolatey trip down memory lane. 30 years ago, you couldn't get him off our screens, but then he rode out of town into the sunset. But we've tracked him down in Stoke, and he's agreed to mount his hoss for one more time. Please give a huge Albert Wall welcome. Well, Albert Wall, I've picked up my words up, that's not a joke. Welcome. Welcome to Jonathan Pierce, the original Milky Bar Kid! The Milky Bar Kid is strong and tough, but only the best is good enough. The milkiest milk, the whitest bar, Nestle's Milky Bar. Sit down. Now, just angle your chair towards me like a chat show. Right, knowing me, Alan Partridge, you've changed. Knowing me, Alan Partridge, knowing you, Jonathan Pierce, the Milky Bar Kid, aha. Right. Was that an aha, or were you just clearing your throat?
I was just clearing my throat.
Okay. Now, do you want to get the aha out of the way?
Aha.
Cheers.
Do you want one?
Nah. Now, who could forget 25 years ago we all used to love the Milky Bar ad with that lovely song implying you were strong and tough when you were clearly an undersized blonde boy. In fact, the type of person who would be bullied at school. But we all loved you and your catchphrase, "The Milky Bars are on me." What have you been up to since?
Well, quite a lot, you know. I've been having a good time. The advert was great fun.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the kids always used to sort of shout my catchphrase in the street and stuff at me. But you know, as it wore off, the pressure grew, and when I was 12, I started drinking. The acting dried up. Oh. You know, they replaced me in '74 with another kid. I got a part in Poldark as a cabin boy. Oh. But that was it, really. My father and then manager ripped me off when I was 15. He ran off with my girlfriend. I earned about £200 from the advert. I spent the money on the guitar and tried to start a band. That didn't work, so I sold the guitar for drugs. And about 25 years old, I started selling my body for sex.
Jesus Christ.
Then things really got bad.
Oh, you know, dear.
I moved into a hostel with a guy called Peter, who was really nice, actually. He really sort of, he got me back on my feet, you know?
Oh, great.
It was the first guy that ever actually didn't take me for granted, you know, and which was great. But I screwed that up. I paid him back by breaking into his room and I stole all his money. And I broke his heart, you know, I broke his heart. I ruined his life like I ruined mine.
The Milky Bar Kid is strong and tough, but only the best is good enough. The milkiest milk, the whitest bar, Nestle's Milky Bar. sold yourself for sex.
Yes, I did during my 20s. It was a dark time for me, a difficult time, you know.
How do you feel about that?
I'm ashamed.
Well, you know, we've all done things we regret. It's all right, I don't want sex. or a Milky Bar. Let me ask you a question. I want you to be strong. I want you to be brave. When you had sex with these men, terrible, terrible thing, did you actually, when you were having sex, were you actually wearing the costume?
Yes, I was wearing the costume.
And did you say the catchphrase?
After they'd finished, yeah, I said the catchphrase.
Which was?
The Milky Bars are on me.
Yes, I can see how that would work. Yes. I was hoping things would lighten up again. Now it hasn't. But how did you... I mean, you were a grown man then. Where did you get the costume from?
I found a sewing machine in the skip, and I made myself some chaps from an Adidas bag.
Really? Is there enough material in an Adidas bag to make chaps?
Yeah, absolutely, because you don't need any material here or here.
Do you think that the Milky Bar Kid is strong and tough enough to change the subject?
Yeah.
Now, how's your life now?
Good, yes. I've kind of moved on, really. I've got myself back together and making things happen.
Right. What are you doing now?
I run a hardcore porn website.
Oh. Does your girlfriend mind?
Well, I don't actually have a girlfriend, Alan. I'm gay. I have
absolutely
a boy.
Fine. Absolutely fine. Yeah. Fine. Let's talk gay. Let's talk gay. Now, certain words. It's interesting. This, but certain words have been reclaimed by the gay community, haven't they? Like queer, sausage jockey.
I'd have to disagree with the second one, Alan.
Okay.
Really, it's all about context, you know. People, like, for instance, I was leaving the house the other day with my boyfriend, and there were some kids on the other side of the road, and they went, oh, you know, there they are, the queer bastards.
Marvellous sense of humour.
Alan, I was offended by that.
Oh, I see. Sorry. Okay. Okay. Tell me then. How do you relax? And I don't mean poppers.
I just like chilling out with my friends. I go clubbing, you know.
Right. Okay. Clubbing. Mm. Okay. Well, here's the thing, which I find fascinating. Here's a hypothesis. Whole gay club scene. Very curious. Here's a hypothesis. I'm a gay man. I'm in a bar with other men in cowboy gear called, I don't know, Oklahomos. I'm tripping the light fantastic. I'm sweating. I spot a chap. He gives me that look. Within half an hour, we're back at his pad. We put on some music. I suggest Steel Eye Span. He wants something light. We compromise on Seal. You can cut the atmosphere with a carving knife. It's electric. The atmosphere, not the carving knife. His feathers are dripping.
His feathers?
Yeah, sorry. He's dressed as a Native American. I forgot to mention that earlier. He rips off my Adidas chaps. I insist he uses a condom, a dicky jacket. He refuses. I insist. He threatens me with his tomahawk.
Sorry, what's your point, Alan?
I've forgotten, actually. But anyway, talk about that golden period when you were the Milky Bar Kid on our screens.
Well, to be honest, I don't want to talk about that period of my life. It was a difficult time. I'd rather just kind of, like, forget it. Let's talk about what happened after. I thought that's why I was here, you know?
Will you put on the hat and sing the Milky Bar Kid song?
No, Alan, I don't want to... That just reminds me of a bad time in my life when I turned to drink.
Stop talking about your personal problems!
But it helps if I talk about it, you know?
Yeah, I know. Just don't. Do you want to pop the hat on and sing the song?
I don't want to do that.
Do you want to sing the song? Yeah, okay. Put the hat on and sing the song. Go on.
It's not...
Sing the song. Go on.
Milky Bar Kid is strong and tough, and only the best is good enough.
The milkiest?
Get off me!
Okay.
Get off me!
Okay, calm down!
Get off me!
All right. Now, listen, be calm, okay? I am your friend. You can trust me, Milky.
Jonathan!
Yeah, whatever. Okay, you are strong and tough. Only the best is good enough. Milkiest milk, the whitest bar. Nestle's Milky Bar. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. Get him! Get him! Get him! Get him! Here. Go on, take him off. Go on, get him. Take him off. Yeah. Yeah. That's a real criminal. Okay. Okay. Now, it's time for the final act. Please give a big warm welcome to Little Britain.
It says here there was a bucket stolen in the village on Tuesday.
Oh, it was a crime wave.
Mum? Dad?
Morning, son.
There's something I want to tell you both.
Put your paper down, Dad. Now, what is it you want to say?
Now, you... Now, you may have noticed I haven't really had any girlfriends.
Well, you used to go out with that girl from the chip shop.
Hey, please, that was just a phase. Don't mention that again.
What, that girl at school, the one with the lazy eye? I thought you were quite taken with her.
Again, the folly of youth. No. What I want to tell you here today is that I am, in fact...
Asthmatic?
No. I am a gay.
Oh, that's nice, dear.
Yeah, good for you, lad. It says here that the bucket had a chrome handle.
Ooh.
So you don't mind?
No.
Of course not.
So you're not going to disown me, you know? Cast me asunder?
No. To be honest, love, we did have a bit of an inkling.
So you got a boyfriend then?
No.
Oh, have you not been having any arse action at all?
No. No, but I have been thinking about having it, which may shock you.
Oh, we'll have to try and fix you up with someone.
Well, that won't be very easy, I'm afraid, as I am, centre stage, the only gay in the village.
I tell you what, there's a right handsome lad who works down the mine. He takes it up the chuff.
No, thank you.
Oh, no, I tell you, he's mad for cock. No, gay Aled, who runs the sauna.
Gay Aled is not gay.
Your uncle glints at him. Apparently, he's very into water sports.
Oh, that's nice for them.
Yeah, lovely.
Yeah.
Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to invite the whole family to come here on Sunday. I don't think they'll like it, but I think it's time I told them.
Oh, I'm not sure Sunday's going to be any good, love.
Why not?
Well, your Uncle Gareth is going to be at the Mardi Gras in San Francisco.
Your cousin Bryn is going down to Cardiff to watch Betty Midler.
What about Auntie Seanad?
Oh, no, she just stays in on a Sunday and eats minge.
Sorry about that. Just caught me mid-dump. OK, now, so I'll finish it later. So, thank you to Little Britain, to Matt Lucas, David Williams, Moana Banks, Ricky Gervais, Rob Brydon, Rich Hall, Rob Cole, Noel Fielding, Simon Pegg, Hugh Parker, and you for being very generous and always having a marvellous evening. Thank you very much.